الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار.
الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد. أما بعد، all praise due to Allah. We praise Him the way He deserves to be praised. And we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace and send His blessings and salutations upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Welcome back, brothers and sisters in Islam. We will continue with our discussion on the major adhkar, or the remembrance that we're supposed to engage in the morning and in the evening. And I just wanted to make a quick comment about the timing of the adhkar of the morning and the evening, because there's a scholarly difference of opinion. And I want to mention the most popular opinion that most of the scholars incline towards, and that is that the time of the morning adhkar is from the time of Fajr, from the time the Salat of the Adhan al-Fajr is given, which is the entrance of Fajr time, up until sunrise. However, if someone fails in doing so, in finishing the adhkar within that allocated time, then one may do so afterwards, up until dhuhr, according to some opinions, hoping that Allah Azza wa Jal will accept that from that person. And for the adhkar in the evening, then it is supposed to be from asr until maghrib. Even though there's another popular opinion that it could be from maghrib afterwards, the stronger opinion, wallahu a'lam, is that it's from asr until maghrib. If someone fails in doing so within that allocated time, then one may say the adhkar afterwards, hoping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept from them. And so if we remember Allah during those two times, you're technically ensuring that you're in a state of remembrance and you're in a state of protection all the time. So now we will be dealing with one of the important adhkar that is related to both the morning and the evening, with a slight variation in the words depending on the time. So you could either say asbahna when it's morning, or amsayna when it's evening, and at some point you say hadha al-yawm, this day, or hadhihi al-layla, this night, depending on whether you're saying it in the morning or in the evening. Of course, when you memorize this from the source, from the actual book, then it will be easy for you to make that distinction and differentiation. It's just a couple of words. It's not too much, inshallah. But just to give you the summary and the actual wording of the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us to say, أَمْسَيْنَا وَأَمْسَى الْمُلْكُ لِلَّهِ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير اللهم أني أسألك خير ما في هذه الليلة وخير ما بعدها وأعوذ بك من شر ما في هذه الليلة وشر ما بعدها ربي أعوذ بك من عذاب من سوء الكبر ربي أعوذ بك من عذاب النار وعذاب القبر أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. In English, the meaning says, we have entered on this evening, and all of the kingship while entering the evening belongs to Allah. All praise is due to Allah. There is no deity worthy of worship besides Allah alone and without any partners. To Him belong kingship and praise, and He is able to do all things. My Lord, I ask You for the goodness of this night and the goodness of what is after it. I also seek refuge in You from the evil of this night and the evil of what is after it. My Lord, I seek refuge in You from laziness, subhanAllah, from laziness and miseries of old age. My Lord, I seek refuge in You from punishment in the fire and punishment in the grave. And similarly, in the morning you will say the same dua, but it will be with asbahna as opposed to amsayna, and hadha al-yawm instead of hadhihi al-layla. But you can see in this particular dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that you're asking Allah Azza wa Jal to give you all types of good in that night and what's after. And then when you say this in the day, then during that day and what's after. And you also seeking refuge with Allah from all the evil in the night and what comes after that night. And this is from the beauties. Notice also that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to seek refuge with Allah from laziness. And this is a quality that is prevalent in the Muslim Ummah today. The Muslims, illa man rahim Allah, can be very lazy. And brothers and sisters, this quality is not befitting. If we continue to eat unhealthy and just, you know, people watching TV all day and not engaging in anything that is useful for the body, then ultimately this will lead to a state of laziness. And this laziness is something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to seek refuge with Allah from in the morning and in the evening, indicating that a believer should be always in a state of being alert, being fresh, being physically fit, being ready, in the state of getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being mindful of Him, both physically and spiritually. And that, of course, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam seeking refuge with Allah from all types of punishment pertaining to the hellfire and the punishment of the grave. And this is a clear hadith that basically educates those who claim that there is no punishment in the grave, those who deny the punishment of the grave. This dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a clear-cut evidence that he used to seek refuge with Allah from the punishment of the grave, because the punishment of the grave and the bliss of the grave are real. The believers believe in that, because we have evidences from the Quran and from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the matter of the grave, which is that life in between this worldly life and the life to come. And this is something, my brothers and sisters, we have to prepare for. And among the means to prepare for that is by memorizing this hadith and applying it and contemplating the meanings of the hadith. So when we say it, we will be among those who are mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we see then that there are many different meanings. Of course, if we were to take each one of them and elaborate on it extensively, then, you know, this series would take years. But we're trying to highlight the most significant aspects, things that we can relate to. Again, most of us, when they memorize these adhkar, they wind up memorizing the Arabic text only and never really get the chance to read the English equivalent, and so they're not familiar with the meaning. The same goes for the Quran in Ramadan. And the Quran is the greatest form of dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you recite in the speech of Allah. How many of us during Ramadan are reciting the Quran while unaware of the profound message and guidance that are within the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It is really a deprivation. It's a form of deprivation that we read while being unaware of the meanings. And so the objective is, at least if we know that when I say this dhikr, I am asking Allah for such and such, and I'm seeking refuge with Allah from such and such, it is means for you to say this dhikr and this dua with a heart that is burning for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a heart that is mindful of Allah. You are saying it and you mean it. You're not just like a parrot repeating words without knowing the meanings behind it. This is the point that we're missing in our lives, I believe. From my experience, the most significant aspect of this is a lot of Muslims don't know what they're saying, whether in dua, whether in dhikr, or in the Quran. And we're trying to remove this veil of lack of knowledge from in front of us so that we can become familiar with the meanings. I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make this a source of blessing and beneficial for all of us. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار